Hi, this is Scott Wilkinson, host of Home Theater Geeks. In episode 205, I chat with consultant David Reisner about the evolving standards of digital cinema. So stay tuned.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for Home Theater Geeks is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Home Theater Geeks with Scott Wilkinson, recorded May 8th, 2014. Episode 205, Digital Cinema from the Inside. This episode of Home Theater Geeks is brought to you by NatureBox, where you can order great-tasting, healthy snacks delivered right to your door. Forget the vending machine and get in shape with healthy, delicious treats like Pear Praline Crunch. To get 50% off your first box, go to naturebox.com/twit. That's naturebox.com/twit. Hey there, Scott Wilkinson here, the Home Theater Geek and editor of avsforum.com. This week's guest geek is David Reisner, a consultant to the digital cinema industry and a longtime friend of mine who has been on the show some years ago. Hey, David, welcome back.
Hey, Scott, how are you today?
I'm doing great. Thanks.
Thanks for having me back. I enjoyed the last time. I look forward to this one.
You bet. It's going to be loads of fun. Now, those of you who are watching the show live at live.twit.tv or logged into the chat room at irc.twit.tv can post questions for David as we go along, and I will pass along as many as I can. Now, David is one of the most eclectic guys I know. You actually have more different types of business cards than anybody else I know for all the different things that you do. Besides what we're going to talk about today, you actually told me earlier that you did a photo spread for Italian Vogue magazine.
It's out there, 14 million copies of one set of things. And I did a celebrity spread for Italian Vogue. That was fun. Very gratifying.
Incredible. You also developed a technique for training killer whales for SeaWorld.
Yeah, Shamu was, and I believe still is, trained using a technique I developed for SeaWorld using sound projected underwater in a, what we'll call a synthetic language, though that's so easily misunderstood. But nonetheless, it worked well.
You weren't actually communicating with the whales, were you?
Not having a conversation, certainly. That was how the trainers told the whales what they wanted them to do, and it worked better than the hand signals and the other methods that they were using, both in terms of reliability. The whales learned the language I designed within a couple of days, so that was probably a good job there. Also, they find it less annoying than the trainer's other methods sometimes. You don't want to annoy a killer whale. It's not a good idea.
I can imagine not.
Yeah, well, they're sensitive to the fact that people are not whales, that they're more delicate. But nonetheless, when you weigh what a killer whale weighs and you have the strength it has, you've got to be very delicate.
Yes, indeed. And also, next week, you are addressing the International Space Development Conference on the subject of transhumanism. Now, this is not the subject of today's show, but give us a little taste of what the heck is transhumanism.
Sure. Transhumanism, as we all know, people evolved to where we are now, and we are continuing to evolve, but probably very slowly, especially with things like medicine and that kind of stuff. Transhumanism is about how you can enhance people. Some of it is drugs to improve memory and that kind of thing, which a bunch of people do some. Some of it could also be implants, technology that is attached to people, and certainly that's used to remedy things that are broken sometimes now, but you could also use it as an enhancement. And eventually some of it might be uploading into a computer. There's a lot of different potential futures there.
Wow. I don't think you've seen Transcendence yet, this relatively new movie that came and went, unfortunately.
No, I have not. I look forward to seeing it, and maybe I have to see it before the conference next week.
You really should if you can, if it's available. I don't think it's on Blu-ray yet. It came and went out of the theaters so fast. It got very low scores on Rotten Tomatoes, which I was very disappointed in because I thought it was fantastic. And it addresses exactly these issues that you're talking about, uploading human consciousness, enhancing human capabilities with technology. It's a wonderful movie. I really enjoyed it tremendously. I thought it was a thinking person's sci-fi movie, right on the cutting edge of quantum computing and artificial intelligence and nanotechnology and all these things that people are talking about. Highly recommend you see it, especially if you can before you go give this talk.
I will certainly see it, whether it's before the talk or not. Fingers crossed.
Yeah, exactly.
Unfortunately, people don't like thinking people's movies as much as they like action movies some of the time. But you can have both, of course, and I suspect Transcendence has a bit of both.
It does. It certainly has some action in it. There's no question about it. Some guns and even cannon fire, as I recall. But that's not the central thing about the movie. It's much more thoughtful. So anyway, that's neither here nor there.
I look forward to it. I love movies, obviously.
Yeah, obviously, because what we're talking about today is your work in the field of digital cinema. And you have been very deeply involved in the whole development and rollout of digital cinema. In fact, I have to say up front here that you actually recently won an Academy Award.
It's true.
Which I'm very, very proud of you for. We have a picture of you at the podium.
I was briefed. There's the award itself. It's not a statue. It's a certificate. That's what they do for technical. But
So there you go.
I'm pleased to share it. I'm very enthusiastic about having received the award. Though I admit, I have to say I'm more enthusiastic about the fact that 90% of movies are made using the technology that Josh and I and the rest of the team developed. 70% of scripted television shows, 99 or 100% of visual effects, what's called turnover, is done with it. So we hit a good spot. We did a good job, I think. I'm very pleased.
Yeah, no kidding. And I think in 2012, you won an Emmy.
It's true. For the same technology, it's about 70% of scripted series television uses it, and the Television Academy recognized it with an award earlier. It's not about the awards, but the awards are nice. It's nice to be recognized for what one has done.
Yeah, no kidding. Give us a little bit of what you won these awards for. I realize it's probably pretty technical and a little too much for the majority of our audience. Not all of them, though. There are quite a few people here who work in that industry. But just give us a sense of what was it that got you these accolades.
Sure. I will keep it short, but somewhat technical, but still short. It's called the American Society of Cinematographers, the ASC CDL, Color Decision List. And the idea is that the cinematographer and the director and the production designer and all have a vision for the movie. And that starts with the shooting that's done on set, or at least for parts of the movie that starts that way. So the idea is to protect that vision from onset through to what's called dailies, where everyone gets to see this stuff for the first time, into post-production, where the key work putting things together is done, and also into visual effects, and then putting it together to have the actual movie. And the ASCCDL helps protect that vision and pass that vision through that chain, and doing it in a way that people can use the work that other people have done to do their next step. So it helps keep the team going, too.
While keeping the color, for example, being a color decision list, consistent throughout that entire chain.
It's partly keeping the color consistent. The key thing is passing the idea, what's called the intended look, through the chain. That's the bigger trick. Well, getting the color right through the chain is very tricky too, and it requires some things that we can't make people do. We can only encourage them to do.
But there's more to a picture than color, of course. There's dynamic range or contrast, resolution, and so on.
Absolutely. And that's a big issue at this point, especially in consumer displays. People have the idea that, look, 4K is an easy number to say. It sounds nice. It's good marketing. 4K is good. Okay, I was one of the people who insisted that we include 4K in the digital cinema specification. But resolution is not the only thing. The contrast, the brightness, that's a big issue these days too in some quarters. The color rendition, the detail, how fine the steps are in brightness and in color. Those are all very important issues. Frankly, a 2K image that has really good contrast probably is going to look higher resolution to most people most of the time than a 4K image that just has okay contrast.
You know, I've always said this, that with this push to 4K or Ultra HD or UHD, as it's called in the home, and there are slight differences actually between those two terms, but they're used more or less interchangeably. But the TV manufacturers are all talking about resolution. They're all talking about, oh, we've got four times the number of pixels of HD. But my contention has always been that if you increase the dynamic range or the contrast between the darkest and lightest parts, you will see the difference much more easily than you will if you increase simply the resolution and keep everything else the same.
No question whatsoever that that's correct. Most people in most environments for home type screen sizes, 2K is probably fine. I see the difference in 4K clearly. Some people claim it can't be seen. That's not my personal experience. But the resolution is an easy thing to talk about, but the luminance, the brightness, and the contrast range are inescapable when you actually see them. The picture can become captivating. There is an artistic vocabulary that has to be developed to use that high brightness well. You can do a little bit with it, but you have to do other things. So wide color gamut is something that is probably also kind of interesting. There's a lot of pieces to how the images get put together. The thing that's driving UHD TV is that consumer electronics companies want to keep selling televisions, and they've reached some saturation on current flat panels. So they want the next thing. And then the other thing is that it's really expensive to make plants that make glass plates for LCDs and even for plasmas also, but especially for LCDs. And they want to make one. Or one per size, not three technologies or three resolutions or anything like that. They want just one. It's a lot cheaper. That's sort of what drove us to digital cinema also. It's cheaper to do release a movie in one way than it is to release it in three ways.
Now, you mentioned, getting back to digital cinema for a moment, you mentioned earlier that a large part of the movie making industry and the TV making industry are now using the technologies that you helped develop to create their content. One question that comes to mind in that regard is, do you have any sense of how many movies are shot on digital cameras versus on film? I know that some directors still prefer to use film for some reason, just like some audio engineers prefer to record on analog tape.
The vast majority of movies are shot digitally at this point, and it will only continue to be that way over time more digitally. There are not many labs processing film. There's only one meaningful motion picture film laboratory in the United States. Deluxe has something running in New York. They've closed down their L.A. facility. Technicolor has something significant in London, or medium significant. But practically speaking, it's getting hard to shoot movies on film. This is a topic that Christopher Nolan and I had a very small disagreement about just immediately after the Academy Scientific and Technical Awards. Daily Variety quoted him saying, hey, you know, film is the gold standard and will be for the next 100 years. And they also quoted me saying, hey, you know, the award that was given this year to lab workers was sort of a goodbye acknowledgement. And you know, it's not an argument, but we see it two different ways. I love film. It's beautiful, but it's not better than digital. It's different than digital. And in a practical world, you kind of got to go digital at this point. I look forward to Chris utilizing that to make more fantastic movies. But for the present, he's going to be making his fantastic movies using film.
What about the digital cinema rollout? We're reaching a saturation point now, aren't we, in terms of the transition from film-based commercial cinemas to digital commercial cinemas?
Sure, yes. The numbers are hard to kind of pin down, but I would, out of, there are about 135,000 screens in the world total, I would say, and about 117,000 of those are digital at this point. So we're doing as around 85% there. That's worldwide, including the U.S. The U.S., it's running about the same percentage. It's maybe 37 or 38,000 digital screens out of maybe 40,000 screens total. So, so we've pretty well converted. Some of the remainders are hard to get, and some of those digital screens are actually starting to deploy their second set of systems now. Some of them are upgrading to higher dynamic range. Some are upgrading to 4K. Most aren't. It's expensive. But a few exhibitors say, people want this, people will enjoy it, and we can make the money. So we will do it.
Regarding 2K versus 4K, as you say, some are upgrading. But that also depends upon whether or not the DCP, the digital cinema package, which is the file that contains the movie and is delivered currently to the movies, the theater, by hard disk. It's actually a physical hard disk that's delivered to the movies. Am I correct or am I not correct that those are mostly 2K files at this point, or is that changing as well?
There is a mix, but they are mostly 2K. That's fair. Some are going 4K. Sony does a lot of 4K releases, I think predominantly, maybe even exclusively 4K releases. And 4K releases can be played on 2K projectors and 2K servers. The servers can down-convert. But it's still, I don't have numbers, but I would guess that 60%, maybe a little higher, are still going out 2K. That'd be my guess.
Yeah, I would think so too. So if you go to a theater, and there's no way to know really for consumers to know what it is they're looking at. I think 2K generally looks really good, even on a 30, 40 foot wide screen. I've seen plenty of them, and you know, you might think that, oh well, you can see the pixels at that size, but at a proper seating distance, sure, if you're in the front row, you probably can. But at a proper seating distance, I can't anyway. Maybe you can.
I can up through about the second row. But the third, I probably can't. It's different from viewer to viewer, but we worked very hard when we were standardizing digital cinema to come up with something that was going to look good in the theater, that was going to give audiences not just good, but very good, excellent viewing experiences. We set our goal as the answer print. So the kind of best print of the movie when you're in the process of making it, that was our goal for what we wanted to give people in the theaters. And until the systems could do that, until our specifications could do that, until the projectors could do that, the studios were not saying go for it. They were not saying yes. We pushed hard. There were some fights, certainly. Because it's not, you know, it's more expensive to do it that way. But we pushed very hard and we got those to be the standards. So we wrote those standards. I vice chaired essentially all the groups that wrote the SMPTE imaging standards. In this case, SMPTE did more than just standardize. SMPTE actually was involved in kind of figuring out what the technology would really be. That was unusual. SMPTE is the Society of Motion Picture and Television Engineers.
Right, right. Quixton UK in the chat room is asking, what's after 4K? 8K? And Darb says 32K. I mean, where does it stop?
Well, it depends on who you talk to, and it depends on why someone is choosing to do it a certain way. NHK really wants 8K. NHK is pushing on 8K.
This is the Japanese public broadcasting system. And they're really pushing on 8K. You're exactly right. Tell us why.
And because so many manufacturers are, so many consumer products manufacturers are Japanese-based, NHK has a disproportionate influence, I would say. Why NHK wants 8K? A couple of things, possibly. One is that I believe that they're sponsoring the Olympics in Japan in a couple of years. So they want to make their flag wave higher and make their tent pole taller. But my best guess, I was told by somebody who I think has a clue, is that NHK wants the Japanese apartments are small and they pack people tight. And many people do not have windows, and they would love it for fewer people to have windows because they want to pack more people in. That's the country is small. It's got a significant population. So with an 8K display, maybe you can put a virtual window in somebody's apartment. Maybe you can take an apartment, make an entire wall or a big piece of a wall be an 8K display, and not worry about whether or not they have a window. Maybe that's okay.
That's an interesting idea.
Yeah, I think it's a compelling argument, actually. It's different than what we're used to in America or Europe or whatever, but I think it's a compelling argument. for why NHK wants this, and it may be a real reason for developing the technology. Personally, I like to have a window you can open, but you know, that's I'm a kind of old style conventional guy in some ways.
Well, and you don't live in Japan.
That's right.
You know, I mean, you see pictures of people walking around with masks, face masks on all the time, presumably due to pollution, possibly germophobia. But in any event, you may not want to open the window if you live in downtown Tokyo.
Well, and more to the point, if you live in downtown Peking, or maybe Shanghai, but certainly China has some places where you really may not want to open the window.
Yeah, exactly. So, Compy 386 is asking, I'm curious how his process interacts with ICC profiles. This is getting to be a pretty professional question here. But
sure. So I will give the short answer. Yeah. They're kind of parallel processes. We've certainly had discussions with ICC. ICC is oriented towards print primarily. That's where they come from anyway.
What does ICC stand for?
International Color Consortium.
Okay.
And ICC, tremendously successful. When ICC finally got their act together, and it did take a while, the life of people who were doing print and wanted to control how print looked changed, and changed for the better. That was a big deal. Mm-hmm. We do have representatives at most ICC conferences. We have talked with them, but they're really not quite in. Motion imaging is a bit different than print, and related but different.
For one thing, the colorimetry is different because in print you're looking at reflected light. Yeah. Well, I guess in film you are too, reflecting off the screen, but it's really emissive light as opposed to taking a white light source and reflecting it off a surface and getting colors that way. That's been my understanding of one of the differences between TVs and print anyway.
Absolutely correct, Scott. That is a fundamental image, and boy, does it make it tough. In the old days, a few years ago, people making movies often would take pictures on set, and they would take the prints of the pictures and pass them on to post-production, saying, this is what I want it to look like. Well, it's kind of hard to compare what's on the screen, whether it's a flat panel or CRT or the projected screen, and compare that to a photographic print. So that's not the best method, but it's kind of what we had available. So you do what you can.
You do what you can. Yeah, that's true. That's the key thing. Now, we talked also, you mentioned earlier, and I wanted to make sure we get back to this, the concept of color gamut, or in other words, the range of colors that can be represented by a projector, by a TV, and so on. Mm-hmm. And we have a picture, a graphic called, I think, Gamut 2020 P3709, something along those lines. There it is.
Yeah.
Tell us what we're looking at here in terms of the gamut.
Sure. So the colorful kind of upside down horseshoe there is the range of everything that a person, their people can see. And of course, there's variation from individual to individual, but this is the standard one, what's called CIE 1931 2-degree standard observer. That's really the reference we've used for a long time. And we've done testing of that reference, Gary Demos and I and some others, of its use in cinema. And we're very critical about it. And it does do what we need to in conventional cinema. But the little yellow triangle in there is what is Rec 709. That's what HDTV shows you. So HDTV will show you that little yellow triangle of color.
In other words, everything within that triangle is what an HDTV can reproduce and show you.
Yes, that's correct. And then the next triangle, bigger, the black one, I guess, there, or maybe red, is what's called P3. That's approximately the film's color space, and it is also what our minimum reference projector gamut is for digital cinema. In digital cinema, we say if your projector is going to be legit, it's got to be able to do at least that much. Higher is okay, but it's got to be able to do at least that much. The bigger one there, the largest triangle that fills a good deal of that horseshoe, is the specified triangle for UHD TV, what's called BT2020 or Rec 2020. So you can see it's a noticeably larger color space, especially in, for example, the greens, where a lot of brightness lives. whether we will see TVs that actually do that anytime soon or maybe even at all is not completely clear. Even the NTSC standard definition color space, which is smaller than, well, it's very difficult to discuss. The original specification was pretty large, and they made displays that would do that, but they couldn't make them and sell them to people. They were science projects. The phosphors were too expensive and too short-lived. So,
right. In fact, Compy386 in the chat room here is saying again, can't wait till Rec 2020 displays become standard as today's Rec 709. I believe you are of the belief that that may not happen anytime soon or ever.
Yeah, it's certainly the specification has left us in a very uncertain situation because the specified gamut is larger than anybody is likely to build. That makes things uncertain. The specification does not include a standardized way of getting the signals into the televisions. Very important. Doesn't say anything at all about broadcasting those signals, though we have the possibility these days of internet delivery. And I think that if 2020 and 4K becomes popular, it's really going to make broadcast be more and more challenged by what's called over-the-top OTT delivery, internet delivery. Netflix and Amazon could deliver you content however they want, including 4K content and wide color space right now. And there's probably a method for getting it into a screen using something that is kind of more a digital sort of thing than a broadcast sort of thing. So it's very unclear. And manufacturers want to make just one set of displays. I mentioned earlier, they want to make 4K displays in, you know, there's three or five, whatever standard sizes. And that's what they want to sell. And a year or so from now, maybe three, I'm not sure exactly, it's going to be harder to buy a 2K display. It will become relatively costly to buy a high-performance 2K display because the manufacturers want to make one set of displays. It's costly to make products. Keeping the SKU count down is of great interest. Look at what Apple does, right? Great products, great company. But one of their big things, especially pre-Tim Cook, but even with Tim, is to keep the SKU count fairly low. They don't want to have three dozen products. They want to keep it to two dozen products, or even, you know, one dozen if they could manage it. But of course they can't. That's unrealistic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I got a comment here from Lancer in the chat room that leads to my next question. He says, what worries me most about 4K is even more degraded pictures. Can you discuss a bit about bandwidth allocated versus digital noise, artifacting, et cetera? And this leads to the question I was going to ask, which was, I believe, as you do, that over the top or online delivery is really probably the first way that most people are going to see UHD or 4K content on their 4K TVs, but it's going to have to be compressed very severely in order to fit down the average U.S. internet bandwidth, right, going into the home. And so I'm concerned that the picture quality simply isn't going to be as good as broadcast. Up till now, HD broadcasting looks really, really good, even though it's also compressed, but not as much.
Let's see. HD broadcasting, HD delivered by something like Fios, for example, which is good high quality service, even though they have lousy customer service. it's a really good system. It's great. I enjoy watching it, and I don't always enjoy watching things. And certainly OTT is how most people are going to see 4K to start with. And maybe that's the only way people will see 4K, the only practical way people will see 4K. Bandwidth allocation is a strong commercial issue for cable providers, and there's money involved, and giving bandwidth to a signal is costly, and it means you don't get to give bandwidth to other signals. As to how the compression works, you know, there's things like H.264 and H.265 that are in wide use now, but they're both basically 8-bit codecs. 264 certainly, 265 I believe has a 10-bit profile that's coming out. But a friend of mine, someone I admire tremendously, and I don't admire that many people's technical work, Gary Demos, has got a floating point codec that he's developed that uses layered compression. at the bandwidth of H.264, he can get 10 or even 12-bit perhaps signals, certainly 10-bit signals down the pipe, you know, which is way better than an 8-bit signal. H.264 is 8-bit, and you can easily see the difference between an 8-bit and a 10-bit. So there are possibilities. I'm talking to some manufacturers right now to try and get that out there in the world, to try and... Sorry, guys, I'm fidgeting.
No problem.
The Gary's system is very interesting, and instead of using a plain RGB camera, it uses a camera with spectral sensing functions that can sense the strength of light at more than three frequencies. It's not 50 in his case; he just does four. But just by adding the little bit of additional spectral information, you can do a better job of getting things to a person. And the other thing is with UHD TVs and also laser illuminated projectors, which we may start to see in theaters one of these days, those have spectra, their primaries are very narrow spectrally. They're just spikes. All the energy is in one spot, at one frequency or a very narrow range of frequencies.
In fact, we have a picture to show that as illustrate that as well. I forget what it's called exactly. You sent me the file. Do you remember?
I can tell in one moment. I just have to
look. It's called spectral something.
Let's see. Narrow spec. Starts with narrow.
Starts with the word narrow. There it is. Okay, so tell us what we're looking at here.
Okay, so the single lines up and down are what the spectra that we see from LEDs and from lasers are likely to be. You know, maybe not exactly those frequencies, maybe a little left, a little right, but basically that. So a really narrow spike, all the energy is in one place. But the red curve there and the green curve and the blue curve are the energy sensitivity functions of the receptors in the human eye. We have three color receptors essentially in the human eye. And you can see that the sensitivity is kind of broad. It's most sensitive in the middle and it kind of tails off. There's also variations with age and people and that kind of stuff. But You can see that what we're doing is kind of fooling people in a way. What we've been doing, now right now our spectra, our light sources are not that narrow. They're broader than that. They're not necessarily broad. Certainly in a xenon lamp projector, they're fairly broad. But LEDs, they're not real broad. And in laser illuminated projectors, they're distinctly not broad.
They're more like these vertical lines, these red, green, and blue vertical lines that we're looking at now.
Exactly. And so what we're doing is we're fooling people's eye brain systems with these, by giving them a little shot of color for this part of the eye, or this part of the retina, and a little shot of color for this other part of the retina, and this other shot of color for this other part. And the people's brains is sort of struggling and putting that together into something that we feel looks a good deal like the real world. Though I will point out that the way it looks like the real world to me and the way it looks like the real world to you, we have no mechanism for evaluating whether what you see and what I see are about the same or are pretty different. Mm-hmm. We think they're probably about the same, but Maybe that's actually, just because we're not good at thinking about other people so much.
Well, that may be true, too. Joe Kane recently told me that in a narrow band RGB system like those vertical lines we were seeing a minute ago, there could very well be a difference in perception between one person and another. But in a wide band reproduction where the reds, greens, and blues are more broad, as we saw in those curves, there's a greater chance that more people will claim to see and actually see closer to the same thing.
Yeah, absolutely. There's more what's called metamerism with the narrowband spectra, and we're trying to characterize that. There are some live displays. I wish I could show it to you on the screen here, but I can't, where you take a regular incandescent light to light a piece of fabric, for example, and then you take LED lights to light that fabric, and it will just twist your brain if you see how different certain fabrics look. I mean, just a whole different world. There's some really interesting work that's being done with that, but we don't have it pinned down yet. We just really, really don't. And how much does it matter for what we what are in people's homes for what we show people in theaters. Well, if you're the artist, maybe you kind of care a lot. Maybe most people see it kind of reasonably, but maybe a handful of people, or maybe more than a handful of people, see it very not reasonably. So that's funky. And it's way beyond what we understand at this point. And we need to kind of figure it out before exhibitors and others go spending a whole lot of money on this stuff. It would be nice.
On like laser projectors, for example, which are the next big up and coming thing. IMAX has announced laser illuminated projectors. NEC, Christie showed a laser illuminated projector at NAB last month.
Yeah. Yeah. IMAX, for what it's worth, David Keeley, who is their quality guy, the VP in charge of quality, is a good guy, and I trust that IMAX will deploy intelligently. But on the other hand, look, you know, you want to get the brightness up because people like the brightness. They should, and they do. And
especially for 3D.
Well, this is a real issue. The human eye brain system requires about 9.5 foot Lamberts before it can detect color and motion completely. Below about roughly 9.5 foot Lamberts, color vision is limited, maybe a little, maybe a lot, depends on how dark and also the material. And motion vision is limited as well. And these days in theaters, sometimes 3D is going out to the screen as low as maybe 3.5 foot Lamberts per eye, vastly too low. I did some with the International, the Digital Cinema, sorry, ISDCF, too many acronyms, International Digital Cinema Forum. We did, and I designed a test that we showed to about 500 execs in the industry in a real theater. We took over real theater and part of the projection booth, and we put in at the time, this was about 3 years ago, what were the highest end possible collections of projector systems so that we could show 14-foot Lamberts per eye in 3D. And we did
14-foot Lamberts, by the way. 14-foot Lamberts is the standard, the DCI standard, the digital cinema standard for 2D movies. You want to have that much light coming off the screen to see a 2D movie, and you're saying that when you put a pair of 3D glasses on and watch 3D movie, you're only getting 3.5 to your eye or so these days. So you were showing them 14-foot Lamberts per eye in 3D.
Right. We actually did a range of luminances. We did 3.5. We did, I think, 9. We did 14. There was one other one in there somewhere. And we actually mastered the material or remastered the material for those luminances. So we were looking at stuff. We took what we'd mastered for each of the luminances and looked at it at each of the luminances. So if you know that you've got X in the theater, how do you do stuff in post-production to try and make it be good? And I felt strongly that master for 14, show at 14 is what looked best. I think that most people felt showing at 9 was okay. But I think a lot of those people were biased because they had checks involved. I'm not writing the checks. You know, I'm not the one who's spending the money. And that's right. Truly, that's important. You know, and so, but the people that were spending the money, they said, let's do 9. I mean, it's not what we're doing, but that was the goal that they were kind of setting. I still felt that it looked best if you mastered 14. We had Pixar, for example, remaster some material. You know, they can remaster better than most people can because they're going from animation. But we also did, you know, some U2 3D, and we had a nice collection of regular cinema and animation. And 14 looks better. It just does, in my professional opinion, which I think well of.
And I do too. Well, listen, speaking of brightness and luminance, I'd like to turn next to dynamic range and contrast. But if you'll give me a moment to hang out there while I thank our sponsor for this episode, which is NatureBox. Now, everybody knows it's easy to talk tough about eating right, but when you're starving at 3 p.m., all cranky and lightheaded, the evil vending machine can seem like your only friend. I know it has for me in the past. Well, don't give in. Keep your eye on looking and feeling great, and head on over to naturebox.com/twit. All you have to do is click on the continue button to choose between three subscription options and then place your order. This is a subscription service that delivers really cool snacks to your door every month. Once you're a member, you can select which snacks you'd like in your monthly box. You can also select for your dietary needs: vegan, soy-free, gluten-conscious, lactose-free, nut-free, non-GMO. And one of my favorite parts, you can select by taste: savory, sweet, or spicy. NatureBox sends great tasting snacks right to your door with free shipping anywhere in the U.S. Now, we're talking healthy and satisfying snacks like banana bread granola, peppery pistachios, and over 100 more. I'm really digging PB&J granola right now, I gotta tell you. It's really, really good. All with zero trans fats, zero high fructose corn syrup, and nothing artificial. NatureBox is the snack-happy gift that keeps on giving. Order a 3, 6, or 12-month subscription for that special someone, family, or friend. Hey, swimsuit weather is almost here, so it's time to snack smarter. Forget the vending machine and get in shape with healthy, delicious treats like honey mesquite almonds. Also one of my favorites. So remember, get 50% off your first box by going to naturebox.com/twit. Stay full, stay strong. Go to naturebox.com/twit. And we thank NatureBox very much for their support of Home Theater Geeks and the entire Twit network. Okay, David Reisner, we're talking... Thank you. You should try it. It's...
I'm not as growing as I used to be, and I'm trying not to grow out. So, you know, maybe I'd be careful about my selections, but you know.
Yeah, see, there's tons of selections. I've been trying them here, and they are mightily good, much better than the vending machine. I'll tell you that for sure.
Yeah, I believe that entirely.
So, anyway, we were talking about luminance and how much light is coming off the screen and hitting your eye. 2D or 3D, and that has to do with high dynamic or dynamic range. And a lot of what people are talking about these days in regard to Ultra HD, 4K, and so on, is increasing the dynamic range that we currently have in the high definition system. Content is mastered, as you were saying before, for a certain brightness level. And now people like Dolby and others are talking about increasing that range. Give us your hit on that particular part of the puzzle.
Well, I've seen sample footage for high dynamic range imagery that looks really nice. It's easy to see brighter images. It's easy to notice the difference with brighter images, and it's a bit hard to notice the difference possibly just with resolution. As I said before, it's an easy thing to discuss, but not quite as obvious. Wider color gamut, a few of us have seen wide color gamut images, except in real life where we see them all the time. So it's a little hard to know what the impact would be to the viewer in the theater. But certainly Dolby has marketed some professional displays now that will do, let's see, the PRM 4200, which I had a small hand in designing, will do 600 nits. That's, oh.
We've got a picture of that, by the way, the Dolby PRM 4200.
Great. That's six times what's normally done in post-production with the monitor, or 12 times what is seen in the theater. So it's a lot. It's a good deal brighter. And there are nice things you can do with that. You know, you have to learn the vocabulary. How do you use that in an artistic sense? Bill Bennett, ASC, a very good cinematographer, shot some of the footage for Dolby, including the shot with that airplane. And, you know, it does make a difference. When you see it, you'll like it. There's other manufacturers as well. Canon has a display there, DPV3010, which is a smaller display by a bit and will not go as bright. It'll only do about double what is done normally in post-production, which is, again, about double what is normally shown in the theater, because you want to see things brighter on a smaller screen. It's just the way it works. But it's a gorgeous, gorgeous monitor. Too expensive for me, unfortunately, but competitive for professional post-production. That monitor has a 10-bit panel, and the monitors that you are looking at, that almost all of us are looking at, are specified as 8-bit panels, and many of them in practice are 6-bit panels. And when if you actually do the measurements, you should know this from audio, Scott, that people talk about, 18-bit or 20-bit or 24-bit audio, and it's mostly a lie. Maybe it's people being naive. You can't really get there. Certainly you can't get anything like 24 bits without being, in a liquid helium cooled environment. No, I'm serious. Or maybe liquid nitrogen would be sufficient. But it's all right. But it's nothing like what people can do in a recording studio. It's just not the way the physics works. Certainly 18 bits is possible with modern electronics and oversampling and sort of thing. And it might even be that 20 bits can be achieved at this point. I'm not up to date enough to be able to say firmly. I'm willing to give somebody 20 and without complaining too much. But 24, they're just not getting there. Just not happening.
In terms of video, though, we're talking about fewer bits than that. We're talking about, these days, we're very used to 8 bits, which again defines the dynamic range from the darkest to the brightest part of the image. And what we'd like to see is an increase in that, because when we increase the brightness and increase the difference between the dark and the bright parts of the image, we want to make sure that the transitions from one level to the next are smooth. And with 8 bits, when you increase it, the distance between each bit that changes grows. And so you start seeing banding on the screen. It starts looking pretty funky. So we'd like to see 10, 12. Do you think we'll ever see 16 bits in a consumer display?
No. I don't. Ever is a long time. When it's cheap enough and easy enough to build it, then, why not? But in practice, I don't think we need it. 12 bits in a consumer display would be pretty darn nice. But if you look at that Canon DPV 3010, which is an honest-to-God 10-bit panel with a 12-bit input, boy, does it look nice. I mean, I have not lived with it. It's only a 30-inch display. It's intended for professional use. But it looks really good. The colors feel good. The solidity of the colors feel good. And I think that relates to the bit depth in significant part, because it's not that bright. It won't go that bright anyway. It'll only do 100 nits, call it 100 candelas per meter squared, or I don't know, maybe that's about 30 foot Lamberts. So a little more than
standard. Right. But that's the current HD standard. So if you said that this went twice the current HD standard, it must be able to go up to about 200 nits.
The HD standard, I don't know.
I'll take your word for it.
What they actually put in the Rec 709 standard is kind of funky, and how that relates to what people are actually doing, I'm not sure what to say.
Okay.
But
Dolby is talking about...
This is not a dark monitor.
No, I understand. Dolby is talking about monitors that go up to 1,000, or they've even produced a prototype at 4,000 nits. And they're talking ultimately about a monitor that'll do 10,000 nits.
With at least water cooling, maybe more than water cooling. the 4,000 nit display, and it's prototype. I mean, they're developing. Yeah. But it's water cooled, and they're moving the water through there. But Dolby... Dolby has been very successful as a company in a lot of areas, and they are very motivated about these things. They keep wanting to look towards the future. I know a bunch of people at Dolby, and I did some work for them, including on the characterization of the last generation of CRT monitors, so that we could be informed about what we were doing after that. And also a little bit of work on their PRM 4200, which is the display, the 600 nit display you're referring to. And, there's a bunch of good guys there, and Dolby has some money, and they're using it for good purposes. I think well of them.
Yeah, yeah. We have a couple of images here that I wanted to show everybody that illustrates high dynamic range. What we can't we can't really show in one image on this program or on TVs or in the theaters or anywhere, really. Let's start with the two shuttle images. There are two photographs of a shuttle taking off. Here is one where, let's start with the other one, if we would. There you go. Okay, so here's the picture that you would see if you were watching a shuttle launch on your TV or whatever. You see the shuttle and everything, and the exhaust is completely blown out. It's just white.
Right. This is done with a very competent camera. This was done with an Arri Alexa camera, which is a very good camera, and was shot by a very good cinematographer, Bill Bennett, again. And he knows what he's doing, and this is the best you would do using conventional techniques. It's not just a matter of where you set your exposure. It's not like taking the picture with a still camera where you would also have these issues. But the information is gone. Compression schemes that are used these days probably leave 6 or 7 bits of information after they go through the compression pipe. We need to convert to 16-bit floating point, frankly, and maybe 32, but at least 16 to get more of the image data through. But anyway, this is what we get now, and this is right. What the NASA engineers get to see to understand, this is the shuttle. But the same thing might be true for SpaceX, for example, right now. They get to see something like this to understand what their engines are doing. But the next engine,
here it is. Tell us about this.
So this is using some of the techniques I was talking about earlier that Gary Demos has been developing and pioneering. And you can see that there's a lot of detail in that exhaust. You can actually see shape in the exhaust clouds, if you will. I'm not sure what to call it. But there's a ton. If you look closely, there's a ton of information there. And these images were the first arrangement we could make with NASA to be able to do a test. You know, if we were, for example, to make an arrangement with SpaceX where we could be closer for launches and have more time to set up and could customize things more, I think we could do even a good deal better than that. And that's pretty good difference right there.
Yeah. But ideally what the goal would be to have a display that could show both of those images in one image, and you could see the detail in both of them all at the same time. That would be what would be a truly high dynamic range display.
Right, and then we want to add to that high frame rates. Use something like the 4A camera. There's a couple of cameras, the 4A particularly I happen to know about, will do 900 frames per second. So if you did an image like that at 900 frames per second and then watched it in slow motion, I feel like you would have some real insight to what was going on there.
Yeah, yeah. I have three other images I want to quickly show, which are also labeled HDR. I think they're HDR1, low, medium, and high. Okay, here is an image of a chairlift, kind of a mountain thing that ferries people up the mountain on a cable. Tell us what we're looking at here.
Well, that's exactly what it is. And the idea with this image is to show the things that are inside the room at a reasonable, normal exposure. But obviously outside the room, things are way bright.
And overexposed. Okay. Yep. Here in this image, we see what's on the outside as being properly exposed, but the inside's totally dark. Any photographer in the audience will understand this problem.
Right. This is a situation where we probably need something like a full 12 or 14 stops of range in the camera, which we can get, and we believe the photographer here did get, but we don't have it in our displays, and we certainly don't have it in our image coding systems, which is, again, why Gary is arguing for floating point and some type of spectral coding.
Right.
These pictures, by the way, were taken by Joe Kane a couple of months ago, and Joe is... and Gary have been working quite actively on this, as have some others, trying to put some of these things together, understand what we need and what will make a difference to what people get to see.
Exactly.
We've got one more image on this. There you go. So you can
go ahead.
I just say you can see that there's a very, very broad range of information contained in those pictures or in that scene, let's say. As fiddling around with the exposures is letting us see.
Right. So here we can see a great deal of detail inside of the hangar where the cars come in. Then there was a mid-range one, and then that's the mid-range one there. The outside is still a little blown out, and the inside is still kind of dark. And then finally we have the one where the outside is properly exposed and the inside is totally dark. So once again, what I'm looking forward to, believe me, is to have a display, a video display, a TV, where you can see all three of those ranges in the same image. And man, that would just be, that would seem to me to be so much more impactful than having four times the number of pixels. In fact, I'd love to see that in HD. I'd be really happy with an HD display, 1080p display, that would show you that kind of dynamic range.
Well, you can't get that. That cannot exist because HD is an 8-bit standard.
And of course.
And that's just not enough. You can even see that in Roberto Rodriguez's second feature release, the sequel. You know, there's people are wearing kind of black gunky helmets instead of oily black hair, which is what was probably on set. We need more than we're getting. Partly that's color, partly that's dynamic range, partly that's steps of detail. We're not going to get that right now. But if you looked at it on a Dolby PRM display or maybe on a Dolby Pulsar, you know, which is the 3000 or 4000 nit display,
right?
Then you maybe have something to look for there. And that would be wonderful. I would love to take that specific image and try putting it on a PRM, on a Pulsar, but maybe we can arrange to do that.
Could. Let's you and I work on that. Let's contact Dolby and see if we can do that, because that would be a really amazing thing.
Sure. We got no problem with between Dave Schnelli and Craig Todd and some of the other guys there. We'll have no trouble whatsoever getting that on a screen.
Yeah, just
requires
exactly.
driving and scheduling.
Yeah, exactly. Well, in the few minutes we have left, let's talk a little bit about high frame rate, because you referred to that before. You mentioned a camera with 900 frames per second. Well, for movies, that's not necessary. It probably is for NASA analysis of the shuttle launch and how the exhaust from the rockets is doing and so on. But in terms of movies, we've been shooting at 24 frames per second for 100 years, roughly. And now we've started to see a couple of examples of higher frame rate. The Hobbit came out. Both of the Hobbit movies have come out, and you can see them in double that, or 48 frames per second, in 3D. And I'm wondering what you think about high frame rate, whether or not that is another thing in the future that we should be advocating and looking forward to.
For some things, it's easy and clear. For sports, for example, clearly we need a higher frame rate to be able to watch the action better. For telling stories, I happen to like motion blur. I think it helps with the suspension of disbelief. It puts you in the story rather than feeling like you're looking out a window, which is not what you want when you're telling a story quite often.
You're not alone. You're not alone, by the way. I want to tell you that there are a lot of people, especially on AVS Forum, where I work, who feel the same way, that they want that almost slightly unreal look to it, with a lot of motion blur and so on and so forth. I myself feel a little differently. I really like the looking out the window effect, but it's a matter of taste more than anything else, isn't it?
Well, yes, I think that's fair, but I almost think it's fair anyway. Maybe we need to do more research before we know how to say that. For the STEM, the standard evaluation material that we use to design digital cinema, I designed that. And I had some of it shot at 48. Mostly it was 24, but some was at 48. And I didn't like the way it looked at 48. It looked video-y to me. But maybe if we had shot it at 96 instead of 48, and then we had done post-processing to add in some kinds of motion blur to virtually change the shutter angles so that the way the images were captured were different, maybe we could have made it be fast and beautiful. You know? I don't know.
As you say, as you have said, I think on the show already, that we don't know enough necessarily to make some of these decisions until we learn more about how we as humans perceive things and how our technology can address that.
Yeah, I tried to start a cinema research institute to look into some of these things, but it's kind of complicated to start a multi-million-dollar institute. It's just tricky. But we do need to research these things more. I would like to see it. But, you know, there are also exhibitors or consumer electronics manufacturers or other people have different priorities, the reasonable, legitimate priorities. They want to make money on their investments, or they want to please their customers. There's things they want to do. That's fair. But maybe it comes up with different answers than what the imaging purists and the scientists among us come up with. So mm-hmm. that's a balance that we have to strike all the time, UHD TV being one example.
Yeah. QNX Monkey in the chat room is asking, do you think that HFR, high frame rate, will ever be available in commercial cinemas without 3D? Because so far all we've seen is 3D.
Sure. I think that's a kind of a marketing thing. It's if people want HFR without 3D, then the exhibitors will make that available to the extent they can do it with a reasonable investment. If they have projectors right now, they will do 48 at a 3D 48 14 foot Lamberts, then they could deliver 96, at 14 or 28 foot Lamberts, and, 2D. Maybe that would draw audiences well. We just don't know. It's a good experiment. And if all it requires is a different master and different configurations, having somebody smarter than the usual people there, no offense to the usual people, but somebody who can do specialty configurations, to show it, they can start to experiment. Do audiences care about this? Do they like it? That's the key thing. Mm-hmm. Will they come to the theater? Will they buy the tickets? And will they buy the popcorn?
Indeed. You mentioned shutter angle, and I want to make sure everybody understands that because it is a pretty important part of the filmmaking process.
Yeah. The cameras only grab a little bit of light. They're not taking things continuously. When it was film, there's a shutter that's blocking the light, and then it moves out of the way and unblocks the light, and then it moves back and blocks it again, and then the film gets pulled to the next frame. We have something similar in digital. The mechanics of everything are different, but the shutter angle is during that time window between frames. How much of the time are you gathering light? Are you gathering light for just a very short time? Are you gathering light for almost all the time? Or in film and current digital, usually it's around half the time. That's a 180-degree shutter angle. If you had a 270-degree shutter, then you would only be gathering light for a very short period of time, a quarter of the time. If you had a 120-degree shutter, you'd be gathering light for a lot of the time. And that changes how much light gets recorded, and also how the motion blur, the blur of things moving in the world being faster than your recording system, how that shows up in the images.
Right, because the longer the shutter is open, if something is moving, it looks blurry. But if the shutter is only open a very short period of time for each frame, then moving objects move less during that time, and so they look sharper.
Right, exactly correct. Exactly correct, Scott.
Okay. So, but the other problem that I've heard is that if you use a very short time, a low shutter angle, then you get a stuttering effect, particularly at 24 frames per second, maybe even at higher frame rates. It looks like kind of jerky.
Sure. Because there is more time between this image, the image N and image N plus one. When the shutter is wide, the shutter ends pretty close to when the next frame starts. When the shutter is narrow, then the frame ends and there's a larger gap to the next frame. And the
a moving object will have moved from where it's depicted in one frame as opposed to the next.
Yeah, exactly correct. And the question is, what level of motion is a person willing or able to integrate? And that varies, depends on the action. We all see problems with that on fast pans, once in a while on TV and once in a while in some movies, and certainly on YouTube. Sometimes you see a pan that is too quick, that this is exactly the problem that's being exacerbated.
Right, exactly. And so one of the solutions that you just proposed a moment ago was to perhaps shoot at an even higher frame rate than you're going to end up with and apply some sort of post-processing wherein you actually introduce some motion blur. This kind of reminds me of shooting in digital and in post-processing, adding film grain.
Right. Yeah. It's right. Shoot fast and then at a very high frame rate, and then use computation based on those images to make the images you want. And you can then style it after you shoot. You know, the more you can do on set, the more you're able to grab. And if you have the time and willingness and ability in post-production, the more options you have. You can grab a very high dynamic range of image on set. You can grab at a very high frame rate. And then in post, you can decide, how do I want this particular scene to look? In the digital cinema specifications in the early days, I argued, I was almost the only voice really arguing, I wanted individual scenes in a movie to be able to be shown at different frame rates. Nobody else was sympathetic to that.
Sounds kind of complicated to me.
Let's put it this way. I could have added it to most servers with just a few gates. I know how to do that hardware design. That's not a big deal, but maybe I do understand it being intimidating when somebody's trying to just get the basic job done. And if they don't think through what the extra job is, I can understand they're being a little intimidated, a little uncomfortable with that. That's not unreasonable. Mm. But, anyway, a lot of projectors can do higher frame rates than we're seeing. Certainly a lot of cameras can do higher frame rates, and we can pass a lot of them through the pipe, though, again, there's issues of bandwidth. If we were in a all-digital world, those bandwidth issues would be disappearing at the rate of Moore's Law, more or less. We're not in that pure world because people spent a lot of money in the past and have spent a lot of money recently to make their infrastructure, their post-production and production and exhibition systems. And so maybe we have to wait a little bit longer before we have high-speed data as our primary means of communication for everything. That'll probably happen, though.
Well, with that look into the future, I say that we've come to the end of a fascinating discussion, and I want to thank you very much for being here. David Reisner is a consultant for the digital cinema industry, along with many other things, and you can find out much more about him at d-cinema.us. David, thanks so much for being here.
Thank you very much, Scott. It is a pleasure both to be on the show and also a pleasure to be talking with you, even with the audience out in the world, and a good set of questions, by the way.
Oh, well, thank you. Appreciate that.
I mean, a good
set
of questions from the audience. You too, but a good set from the audience is what I'm saying.
Yes, yes, yes. No, I totally agree completely. The chat room here is one of the best, and I always love having them along for the ride. So as I said, you can find out much more about David at d-cinema.us, and you can follow him on Twitter at digcinema, D-I-G-C-I-N-E-M-A. To learn about what he's doing day to day. You can find me, of course, at avsforum.com. You can email me at scott@twit.tv. And you can follow me on Twitter at htgeekscott, also at avsforum. And you can also find previous episodes of Home Theater Geeks right here at twit.tv/htg and on our YouTube channel at youtube.com/twit/home-theater-geeks. Next week, my guest geek is scheduled to be Andrew Cross, the CTO of NewTek, makers of the video switching equipment used right here at twit.tv, to talk about Ultra HD and online delivery. So that should be very interesting. I do hope you will join me. Until then, geek out.